Hello, good afternoon, welcome. We are so excited to be here today with a phenomenal panel celebrating cancer survivors and patients here in our community. This is gonna be a phenomenal health and wellness event, and we have a tremendous amount of resources and wealth and information to share with you today. Please do be patient with us. This is actually our first virtual event. In light of COVID, we had initially planned to have an in-person event, but all things have really transitioned to a virtual format. I'm gonna go ahead and speak a little bit about cancer care in light of COVID, as well as some important tips for survivorship. It's interesting that these two things are very closely aligned. And then we'll go ahead and introduce our panelists and the rest of our team members today. So give me one moment. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen. So again, thank you so much for joining us today. We have a lot of really wonderful things happening at the Cancer Center as well too. And I think we'll really highlight that with a lot of our speakers and panelists today. So it's very difficult to have any type of program these days and not speak about COVID. So I thought it was worthwhile to speak about COVID for just a few minutes. So when the pandemic initially started, we really had very limited data about the effects of COVID-19 and cancer. And as the months have progressed, there have been some actually pretty important papers and research publications that have been presented in a virtual format at our national and international meetings. So because we know that cancer patients are at least twice as likely to become infected with COVID, it's very important that we use some time to talk about how we boost our immune system, how we stay well in light of the pandemic, which is ever present around us. We do know that cancer patients who are on active chemotherapy and immunocompromised are really at higher risk for severe clinical events. So it's very important that we particularly protect our cancer patients, those especially that are on active chemotherapy and immunocompromised. And so when the pandemic initially started, and thankfully we're in a much better place here in New York and New Jersey than other spots of the country, but a lot of our national organizations came together to sort of redefine treatment goals and really talk about the safety of cancer care. So we do have a lot of shared decision-making with patients about the safety of continuing chemotherapy, the risks and benefits, ways to potentially keep patients less immunocompromised. We also are doing a lot more telemedicine now and employing different strategies to reduce visits to the hospital and the doctor's offices. And we're trying to also readjust treatment regimens and screening protocols. I have to say again that we've done such a phenomenal job in New York and New Jersey. So this is less of an issue for us now than it was, say, in March. I actually feel that the hospital is one of the safest places to be in the community, given all the PPE and the protection that we're doing for patients. But certainly in hot spots of the country, in Texas and Arizona and different places, this is a constant dialogue between physicians and patients. So when we're talking about survivorship as well as cancer care during COVID, all of these things are very synonymous. So these are the things that you really need to do to keep your immune system healthy during COVID as well as any time. But it's very important to continue seeing your physicians. Really, if any appointments have been neglected, this is a very important time to do those now. You really want to maintain physical activity at least 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. It's important to have a immune system healthy plant-based diet. And there are definitely strategies to help your mental health, which is so important. Pretty much every patient that I have seen really since March and continue to see now has had mental health issues with being at home, being physically inactive, being sort of socially isolated from friends and family. And we want you to know that you're not alone. We have a lot of virtual programs here at Holy Name. And it's very important that you do these strategies to preserve your mental health. During the 3 months of really severe COVID lockdown here in this part of the country, there was some data that came about that says that there were over 80,000 missed cancer diagnoses across the country. And this was because patients were and people were not going for their health screenings or seeing their doctors. And if you can see on the next slide, these are cancer screenings for breast cancer, colon cancer, and cervical cancer. And this is the data looking at 2017, 2018, 2019, and the present. And you can see starting in March, there was a dramatic drop off in these screening exams compared to prior years. And it's this data was published in May, but it's just a very important point to remember that you really do need to see your doctor. And these health screenings, which are so important to prevent cancer, absolutely need to be continued. As I said in the beginning, the hospital here is a very safe place to be. I think it's much safer than in the community. Everyone is wearing PPE, we're washing our hands, we're physically distancing. So if you've not had your health screenings, your mammograms, your colonoscopies, your trip to the gynecologist, the internist, you absolutely really must do this. Real quickly, we know physical activity is very important. It's very important to boost your immune system during COVID. There's also a lot of data that physical activity helps people who have had or have cancer survive longer. Some of our panelists may speak about this. So I really want to encourage everyone to try and exercise at the minimum 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. Very, very important. And you can certainly do that by walking, getting fresh air. You know, it's warm outside now, so you can go in the morning or the evening. But physical activity is not only important for your immune system and cancer prevention and recurrence, but it's very important as well for your mental health, which is extremely important. COVID-centered diet, which Debbie may talk about a little bit. I know she has a video today, but there are a lot of different strategies to boost your immune system. By the way, I should have mentioned that we're very happy to take questions throughout this presentation. You'll see that there's a little chat box at the bottom of the screen. So if you would please type in your questions and I'll keep track of those. And at the end, we will really do our best to address all of your questions. So please do type those in as we go. Really, the best data is for a plant-based diet. There are a lot of things that you can do to help boost your immune system. And here are just some common things that have been advocated for during COVID to really help boost your immune system. It's really important that we're eating a lot of fruits and vegetables, really a lot of lean meats and whole grains. But these are just a few of the types of vegetables and fruits that have been particularly thought to really help boost your immune system, which is very important during COVID, and of course also very important as we want to keep a healthy immune system as we're trying to fight cancer. Mental health is very important. No time like the present with COVID to really talk about mental health. We do know that physical activity and eating healthy are very, very important in the pandemic and always to really help boost our immune system. At the Cancer Support Community here at Holy Name, which is spearheaded by Courtney, we have a lot of virtual programs which are very important to help you stay connected. So if you have not participated in those programs, I really strongly suggest that you do. We also have a lot of individualized support for people who need it, so you're certainly not alone. Another important thing to help with mental health factors is to really try to avoid alcohol. Initially, when the pandemic first started, we saw that the alcohol sales really increased because everyone was at home, but it's very important to really limit your alcohol consumption. It's very important to try to maintain a normal sleep schedule. If you can really try to go to bed at least by 10 and wake up by 8 or 9, everyone's a little bit different in terms of how much sleep that you need, but sleep is very important to boost your immune system, not only during COVID, but also to keep your immune system strong while you're being treated for cancer and after. And then there are a lot of strategies like meditation, acupuncture, yoga, things that are very helpful in addition to the virtual programs to help keep your mental health happy and secure. So just want to say a few things about survivorship. It's very interesting how these things are very important to talk about no matter what point you are in your cancer journey, but it's also very important to talk about these things as we're all dealing with the COVID pandemic and trying to keep ourselves healthy and safe. So ASCO, the American Society of Clinical Oncology, really talks about cancer survivorship starting right when people are diagnosed with cancer. So you become a cancer survivor right when you're diagnosed with cancer, and that survivorship journey really continues during your treatment and beyond. So we like to think of cancer survivorship and all of these issues that are important to keeping high quality care really starting right away when people are diagnosed. So it's very important that you continue to have surveillance for any issues with recurrence. So continue to see your medical oncologist, your surgical oncologists. It's very important that we also monitor for different medical effects and the psychosocial effects of being diagnosed with cancer. And that's where the cancer support community is so phenomenal, really excellent resource for people to help manage some of those psychosocial effects. We of course want to have screening programs and recommendations to catch or avoid any secondary cancers. It's important that we really talk about some of the potential late-term or long-term effects of cancer treatment. Genetics is very important. You know, genetic testing and the national criteria for genetic testing has constantly evolved. So people who may not have met the national criteria in the past for genetic testing may meet criteria now. So it's very important that you speak to your doctors about your personal and family history of cancer and see if you qualify for any genetic testing. That's certainly important to help prevent secondary cancers, as well as for other people in your family to avoid cancer as well. And now with certain types of cancers like ovarian cancer, certain breast cancers, pancreatic, prostate cancer, for example, there are new targeted agents that we can use to help prevent recurrence and treatment. It's really important right when you're diagnosed with cancer, or even if you've never had cancer, to get a lot of guidance about healthy diet, plant-based diet, appropriate exercise, as I said a few times, and a lot of different things to help promote cancer activities. We do know that men and women who've been diagnosed with cancer, regardless of where you are in the cancer journey, can really help prevent recurrence and live longer with healthy plant-based diets and appropriate exercise. Very, very important. It's also important we do have a lot of financial and insurance assistance here with our social workers, and we really want to empower our survivors to advocate for yourself. If you're not feeling well, if you have concerns, if you have needs, we are all here for you, the entire team. So it's very, very important. These are sort of national guidelines that have been put forth with quality survivorship care. I think in light of our celebrating cancer survivors, it's really important to talk about these. We all should be addressing these right when people are diagnosed with cancer and certainly throughout their entire cancer journey. So even though I've said this several times, I always think it's important to reiterate the importance of really taking care of your mind and body. You know, there's no better time in light of a pandemic and in light of celebrating cancer survivors to really keep these things in the forefront. Talk to your doctors, definitely see them, please, on a regular basis. Really maintain a healthy body weight. We do know that about being obese or overweight is now associated with about 13 different kinds of cancers. It's probably the number one risk factor for cancer in the United States. So it's very, very important to maintain a healthy weight, to stay as lean as possible, to definitely help prevent cancer and cancer recurrence. As I've said, you want to increase physical activity at least 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. Eat a really heart-healthy or plant-based diet. Take care of your mental health. Find ways to manage stress, whether it's meditation, acupuncture, yoga, social activities that are safe from a physical distance standpoint. Really have good sleeping habits. Monitor your alcohol intake. Certainly no smoking or vaping. And then really definitely continue your health maintenance exams. It's important to have an annual mammogram at least. Have a colonoscopy, depending on your risk factors, starting at the age of 45, at least every 5 years. Certainly see your gynecologist and your internist every year, but these are very important strategies to help stay safe and to stay cancer-free and to keep your immune system as strong as possible. So with that, thank you for the questions. I'm going to go ahead and keep those cataloged. I'd like to go ahead and introduce Jean Jordan. It is a real pleasure to have Jean Jordan here at Holy Name. She is the Vice President of our Oncology Services. Jean was a tremendous recruit from Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center and has been a tremendous asset to our team here at Holy Name. And with that, I'd like to turn this over to Jean to say a few words, please.
Hi, everyone. I really just wanted to take this moment to have the chance to greet you all and basically to show gratitude. And certainly thank you to Sharon for the wonderful intro and for her ongoing support. Thank you to Courtney for all the hard work to arrange this event. You know, we couldn't celebrate in person this year, but it's so important for us to have the opportunity to celebrate cancer survivorship, survivors, survivor caregivers, And this is a really awesome opportunity to do so. Again, we can't wait till we can be together, but we're glad that we have the opportunity to be together in this way. Thank you. You know, moving on to my role at Holy Name, thank you to our great team across the oncology disciplines. I came to this job at Holy Name a year ago, and it's been so incredible. It's really a life's calling coming full circle, and I'm so grateful for the opportunity. So, and you know, more than anything else, thank you to all of our patients for allowing Holy Name to be an important part of your lives and care. You know, put simply, our goals are to continue to strengthen the full complement of cancer program services and to ensure they're integrated for a seamless patient experience. This is what differentiates care at Holy Name, the Holy Name style, being part of the Holy Name family. And just to sort of tag to a bunch of the things that Dr. Lewin mentioned, and a bunch of the progress that we've made in terms of really facilitating the integration of our program and continuing to develop. You know, it's really important that we have within our network primary and specialty physicians care before, during, and beyond the cancer journey, advanced diagnostic opportunities for patients, obviously medical, surgical, and radiation oncology services, social support and activities, again, through our cancer support communities. We have transportation opportunities for patients, you know, assistance with fiscal management, psychosocial support for patients and caregivers, clinical trials opportunity. This year, we had the opportunity to partner with several other hospital programs in New Jersey on a National Community Oncology Research Program grant. So it's providing us with lots of opportunities to offer additional clinical trials to our patients. Genetic screening and counseling, clinical affiliation with Mount Sinai, which some people may or may not be aware of, and certainly nutrition programs. That's sort of my broad swath of everything that we have been working on. But I want our patient population, our survivors, all of their family members to know that these are the things that we're going to integrate to be able to continue to provide a wonderful program. And in short, I just offer the opportunity for anybody to reach out to me with feedback or if I can help you in any way. I think that our contact information will be shared with the participants of this group, and I welcome hearing from patients, their family members, or anybody that I can actually help and things that I can learn to make sure that we continue to improve our program. And I'll part now and move on to the next speaker, but if there are questions for me, I'll be back at the end to be able to answer. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Jean.
Okay, hi, I'm Courtney Lozano. I'm the Program Director for Cancer Support Community, and I'm here today to talk to you about all of our cancer support programs and how we can get you involved. So just bear with me 1 minute. Okay, so before I start today, I just want to acknowledge all of the cancer survivors who are joining us today. And we want to recognize the medical teams, the caregivers, and the loved ones who have been there for you along the way. Whether you are in treatment or post-treatment, meeting others who have been down this road is so powerful. And it is so important to make a connection with those who understand. And we want to ensure that you can stay connected, which is where the cancer support community comes in. So through the cancer support community, we offer a lot of different free cancer support programs, and they're open to anyone who's impacted by cancer, regardless of where you're getting your cancer treatment. So even if you're not a patient of Holy Name, you're receiving cancer treatment at another hospital, you're still welcome to join us. When someone is diagnosed with cancer, it doesn't only affect you medically or physically, it affects your emotional well-being. And that's where we come in. The cancer support community is like the critical missing link. We are here to listen, engage, and support, and there's so many different ways and different support programs that you can participate in. So who can join us? Anyone who's impacted by cancer. So what does that entail? If you're in treatment, if you're post-treatment, if you're a spouse or a loved one, if you're a longtime survivor who's still seeking support, we welcome you. And if you have lost someone, you know, there's a lot involved with the whole cancer spectrum from beginning to end, and that's what we're here for. I think a lot of times, a lot of people are just so focused on the medical piece, their cancer care, you know, their medical treatment that they're receiving. But we want to make sure that the social and emotional piece goes hand in hand with the medical care that you're receiving. So Cancer Support Community is actually a national organization. We have locations all across the US, including international locations that we've just expanded to. So Cancer Support Community was actually formerly known as the Gilda's Club, but they merged in 2010. So we are essentially the new Gilda's Club, just with the name Cancer Support Community. So I think a lot of people were really familiar with the Gilda's Club that was in Hackensack, and they were all over, you know, the country. But now we are known as the Cancer Support Community, and we partnered with Holy New Medical Center in 2016 to just ensure that we can provide emotional and social support to anyone impacted by cancer, including patients and their families. So when this pandemic first hit, we did not skip a beat. We immediately took action. We canceled all of our in-person programming in early March, and we spoke to all of our instructors about, you know, what is a way that we can stay connected and not leave anyone behind. And we basically built this virtual program from the ground up, and this was only possible thanks to our incredible instructors. There are a lot of instructors who are actually on this call today, and we are so thankful for all of the hard work that you've put in to figure this whole thing out. You are so dedicated, and without you sharing your time and talent to be here, this whole thing would not be possible. So your kindness is not overlooked, and thank you very much. So we have three ways to stay connected. The first way is through our live sessions. So some instructors just right out the gate figured out and braved the virtual world and wanted to just continue their programming like they did before. And so at this point, we have 3 to 5 live classes a day. We have stress management, we have yoga, we have wellness workshops. Cancer recovery fitness is actually, it is taught by an oncology fitness instructor, and it's both advanced and beginner levels are both available. So depending on where you are in your cancer journey, you can join either class. We also have meditation classes available multiple times a week at different times of the day. So in addition to these classes, we just ran some really great programs. We just did Reiki 101, talking about, you know, your energy flow. We talked about, we had essential oils and aromatherapy. And just on Tuesday, we did a class on cognitive impairment post-treatment, if you've ever heard of chemobrain. So really educational and informative classes. So in addition to all the virtual support that we offer, we had some instructors just say, you know, how can I help? What can I do? What if I just record myself, you know, in my living room as if I was running a class, and I'll just send you the videos and you can kind of share them. So I was able to basically collect all of this fantastic content from our incredible instructors. We have meditation sessions, yoga sessions, we have fitness tips, photography tips, and not only pre-recorded videos, but they actually sent us links and websites to recipes, craft ideas. I just feel like it's been such a team effort from everyone to make this happen. So all the information I received, I shared on social media. And basically every day we have a different topic, and we share what we've received. So our website on Facebook, if you do a search, it's Cancer Support Community Holy Name. So in addition to those other options, the dial-in by phone option is super simple. Basically, every time we create a Zoom link for a live class, it automatically generates a phone number for you to call in. And it's basically like using a conference call style participation. So you call in, you listen, you participate over the phone. You can't see the instructors, but you can participate in that way if you're not so familiar with the virtual platforms. And if other than maybe fitness or yoga, where you do have to kind of follow along and see the instructors, this is a perfectly easy method to participate. So no matter where you are in your cancer journey, and no matter who you are, whether you are a patient, a spouse, a friend, we have different programs available for anyone. And at this point, all of our programs are completely virtual, and we have had that successful shift since March. But we are looking to plan ahead to figure out a way that we can incorporate some type of hybrid model that includes both our in-person classes with our virtual classes, but we're looking to use our in-person classes in some type of outdoor setting. And, you know, with our social distancing and with our safety precautions. We have a lot of planning to do, but that's kind of in the works. And we understand that there's going to be two different groups of people. There will be people who are ready to come back, and there will be people who are not. And we respect your decision either way. We just want to let you know that we will develop these two options pretty soon. But I have to say that we do miss everybody. We miss seeing your faces. We miss seeing you in our classes. We miss seeing you in our hallways. And, you know, when we do resume classes, will it feel different? Yes. Will it be different? Yes. But will we be together? Yes. And I think that's really what we have to remember. So a lot of people are very familiar with the term post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, and I think there's a lot of different ways that that can come about, whether you've experienced a major loss, whether you've been through COVID or cancer, or maybe you've been deployed, something major happened in your life where it affects your emotional well-being. And when that happens, you know, it can take a toll on you. But there's also this other concept that's called post-traumatic growth. So post-traumatic growth is actually the concept that living through a major life crisis can actually make you stronger. And post-traumatic growth is a positive change that can occur after enduring a traumatic event. So some people just have this resiliency that kind of comes out after a major life crisis. And there is some growth that can be seen after trauma. So if you've ever heard the saying, like, I feel like I have a new lease on life, or I really, you know, you appreciate your life so much more. Maybe you've developed closer relationships. Maybe you've taken the time to really tell people in your life how much you care about them. New possibilities in your life. Maybe you're taking more risks than you have before. Increased personal strength. And, you know, sometimes there's this existential or spiritual change where you think to yourself, you know, maybe this is why I'm meant to be here. Maybe this is why I'm supposed to be, you know, helping other people like me, or whatever you're thinking. So it's just a really interesting perspective when you think about, you know, when you've been through a really tough time, sometimes there is some positivity to that. So in addition to all the group support that we offer, it's really important to know that we also have one-on-one phone counseling. So the medical care that you receive is critical to your survival, but at the same time, we have to be just as intentional about our emotional health as we are about our mental health, and as with our physical health. So if we're so focused on the medical piece that we don't think about the emotional piece, they really should go together. And so we want to make sure you are aware that these free programs are available. We have the call-in line, and you can call whether you speak English or Spanish. They have available support for you. So in addition to the other programs we mentioned, we also have this peer matching program that we rolled out last year, which Dr. Lewin is actually heavily involved in. And basically it is a program specifically for women who have a gynecological cancer. And what we do is we pair up two women, one with the same cancer, and one is newly diagnosed, and one is 2 years post-treatment and or more. And so when you are newly diagnosed, you do want to talk to someone who's been there, who's been down this road, can help you, you know, answer some questions. And that's what the mentors are there for. It's a really incredible program. And whether you are newly diagnosed or if you're 2 years or more post-treatment and you want to become involved with this matching program, this is a great thing to consider. So I have two partnerships that I want to talk to you about before I finish up. So Airbnb actually partnered up with Cancer Support Community 2 years ago to ensure that they can provide free housing accommodations for people who have to travel for cancer treatment. So if you are traveling more than 50 miles for your care, you can look into Airbnb for an Airbnb location to stay while you're traveling for your care. And we are so lucky to live in this tri-state area where we have all these fantastic hospitals right around us, but not everyone has that. And even if you do live here, if you have a specialty surgery that you need to have, or the diagnosis that you have, you know, is with a hospital that's not nearby, this is really you know, genius, whoever developed this this collaboration. And also in March, basically they shifted their mission to incorporate frontline workers into this housing, free housing model. And so if you're working on the front lines, you're really uneasy about bringing coronavirus home to your family, basically they wanted to ensure that that was an option. And so we just wanna make sure that you know that this exists. If you wanna become a host and open your home, if you are looking to travel for treatment and you're trying to figure out the plan, take a look at their website. It's cancersupportcommunity.org/Airbnb. So lastly, this is a little bit confusing, but I'm gonna make it simple. Look Good, Feel Better was a program that was around for many years, but it has basically been revamped to now be called Feel More Like You. And Feel More Like You basically collaborated with Cancer Support Community and Walgreens stores nationwide to basically train their beauty consultants on site to really understand what happens when someone is going through cancer treatment, what side effects they have, and you know how to really help people who are going through this. So now we have access to all these great podcasts and workshops and individual consultations to help with makeup, skincare, and beauty tips. And we are going to be collaborating starting in the fall to do some workshops. And there's someone who's on our call today who's here to talk about this specific program, and we're really looking forward to hearing more about that. So we would love to have some new faces join our program. If you want to jot down my information, everything's here. And while you're doing that, I just have one last thought that I want to finish up with. I feel like there are so many people who come up to me and say, you know, why me? Why did this happen to me? Or how did this happen to my family? Why did this happen to my husband? He is so super healthy. He's a triathlete. He like only eats kale. Like, I don't know how this happened. And I just want to say cancer does not discriminate. It doesn't matter where you came from, who you know, or what type of car you drive. You cannot control who gets it, but we can control the support that's available. And we want to ensure that no one faces cancer alone. And that's why I'm here. I just want to let you know this program exists and that if you or someone you know can benefit, we would love to have you get in touch with us. My information is here. If you'd like to register for a class, all of our information is on our calendar of events at holyname.org/cancersupport. So I know I gave you a lot of information to process. I hope it was helpful, but right now we would like to actually switch gears. And I'm going to introduce our next speaker, our next segment, which is Debbie Besson is our Director of Clinical Nutrition, and she's going to be sharing a cooking demonstration with us.
Hi, I'm Debbie Besson. In honor of National Cancer Survivors Day, I'm so happy to be doing a cooking demo for you in my very own kitchen. I'm going to be showcasing three plant-based meals because plant-based diet is really the best diet for cancer prevention. Plant-based doesn't mean vegan or vegetarian. It just means most of your plate will be filled with plants. Plants like vegetables, fruits, nuts, seeds. We're going to start off with a very wholesome cinnamon oatmeal pancake. We're going to top it off with raspberries, pomegranate seeds, and pumpkin seeds. And the toppings were carefully chosen for their anti-cancer properties. For lunch, I'm going to be making a meatless quinoa taco using corn tortillas, spinach, and avocado. And for dinner, I'm going to show you how easy it is to make your own zucchini noodles, and we're going to put some salmon on top of that. All three recipes are easy, nutritious, and very tasty. This recipe is so easy and it's so clean. That's what I love about it. We're gonna put everything into the blender and then everything into the pan. The first ingredient calls for 3 cups of oat flour. I just take oats and blend them to make my own oat flour. It's less expensive. seeing these little holes, it's time to flip them over. Seeds are really high in antioxidants. There's one super one called polyphenols. Raspberries are also high in antioxidants. They're high in vitamin C and they're really high in fiber, double that of blueberries and strawberries. My last topping, pumpkin seeds, are really high in minerals like zinc and magnesium. They're also high in protein and fiber. And there you have it, a great start to your day. For lunch, we're making meatless quinoa tacos. Everyone loves tacos. So instead of using ground turkey, ground chicken, or beef, I'm going to be using quinoa. Quinoa is a great substitute for meat. It's got all of the essential amino acids, which makes it a complete protein. Along with quinoa, we're going to use black beans, which is high in fiber and protein, corn, which is high in fiber. We have canned tomatoes, which is high in a lot of nutrients. We have the flavoring, which is what's going to make it taste like tacos, which is paprika, cumin, chili powder, and salt. We have spinach, which I refer to as a multivitamin because it's so high in vitamins, minerals, and nutrients and other antioxidants. We have avocados, which is gonna make you feel full and give you some monounsaturated fats to help absorb the nutrients that you're eating. And I'm going to use corn tortillas. Corn tortillas are gonna make the whole taco experience gluten-free. And we start with some water in the pot and add all of those nutritious ingredients. Black beans, canned tomatoes, corn, the flavor, and the quinoa. Mix it up. Bring to a boil. Cover and simmer for 15 minutes. Now, first we're gonna put some spinach on the corn tortilla. We're going to add some avocado. And we're going to top it off with the quinoa filling. Here are your plant-based tacos. This simple recipe calls for two vegetables, one of them being the zucchini noodles. Two vegetables in a recipe is always a good thing. But first, we're gonna start with our salmon. I chose wild salmon. Wild salmon has two benefits over farmed salmon. Number one, it has less calories because it has less fat. Typically, it has about 130 less calories than the same size farmed salmon. The other reason why it's beneficial to buy wild over farmed is the contaminants, some of them cancer-causing. It has about 5 to 10 times less contaminants than your farmed. It still has some, but eaten in moderation, it's a better choice over the farmed. But just like with organic, buying organic fruits and vegetables, if they're not available or if the cost is too high, it's still beneficial to eat your salmon, whether it's farmed or wild. I'm gonna season the salmon with a little bit of olive oil. A pinch of salt and a little squirt of lemon juice. I'm going to put it into my toaster oven on broil for about 5 minutes. While that's cooking, I'm going to spiralize my noodles, my zucchini. I bought this at Bed Bath & Beyond. I think it was maybe $15. It works terrific. I cut up the top. Simply put it in, and start turning. And you can see zucchini turning into pasta. One zucchini makes this whole plate of pasta. Now I'm going to make the dressing. The dressing calls for 1/4 cup of olive oil, 1 garlic clove, minced, a pinch of salt, a squeeze of lemon juice, and 1 cup of fresh basil that I was able to get from my garden. You can use any blender or food processor to make this. To a heated pan, and first I'm going to cook off the kale. Kale is one of the cruciferous vegetables, which I recommend daily because of its anti-cancer properties. The other cruciferous vegetables are broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, bok choy. There's a lot of them that you can choose. One a day, I recommend. We're going to cook this up a little bit, just until it wilts. It gets even greener in color because of the phytochemicals that are breaking down. That's just about right. We're going to take that out of the pan. Smells so good. And now we're going to cook off the zucchini noodles just a little bit, a little bit. So many people have asked me if they needed to boil the zucchini noodles like pasta. That would make for a very soggy zucchini noodle. So all you want to do is not, you don't even have to add extra oil. You just want to cook it up in the oil like base pan. Just again, so you heat it up. Gives it a little bit of warmth to it. Give it 1 more minute. Gonna check on the salmon. It's done. Zucchini noodles are done. You're gonna plate that. Bite-sized pieces, and now I'm going to lay it over the vegetables. You can eat this dish cold or hot. Now I'm going to pour the dressing right over the dish, and there you have it. Thank you so much for joining me today in my kitchen. I hope my recipes inspired you to become a little bit more plant-based.
Thank you, Debbie, for that great video. Next up, we have our health and wellness coach, Atara Weisberger, who's going to be sharing with us some information about wellness and self-care during COVID. So, Atara, you're up.
actually remembered to unmute myself. Hi, everybody. Thank you, Courtney, so much for organizing this and for always being like the warm, happy, amazing, supportive face at the cancer support community. And a huge thank you also to Dr. Lewin. I'm so happy to actually have a face and a name to put together, which is great. I've already learned a lot listening to everybody, so it's really wonderful. And to the participants, thank you for taking the time out in the middle of the day to join us. Really, really happy to be part of this. So thank you to everybody. Okay, so a lot of information has come our way in the last hour or so, which is really amazing. I'm actually gonna, let me try and share my screen here also. One second. Make sure you can see it. Okay. So I am a national board certified health and wellness coach. I was trained at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. And I've been working as a health and wellness coach for about 17 years now. And the main thing that I do is to help people not only kind of understand where they want their lives to go in terms of health and wellness, but also really to help make those changes real and help them stick. So a lot of times we're given a tremendous amount of information and it's hard to know kind of how to adapt that to your real life in real time. So one of the things that I think you're seeing in this whole in everybody's presentations, this is like kind of a synopsis of a lot of what you're hearing, which is that health is a state of body, but wellness is a state of being. So there are people who are physically well, who are physically healthy, and if you ask them if they're feeling well, you can imagine a scenario where somebody would say, no, I really don't feel well. Or, are you sick? No, I'm not sick. But they feel like they're not thriving. They feel like they're not at their best. And there are any number of factors that may go into that. It could be that they have financial stress. It could be that there are other things going on in their lives that they're not sure how to process. It could be like in the times of COVID where it's just difficult kind of not knowing what's going to be from day to day and from, you know, week to week and not being able to plan your life. So even people who are physically well right now, there's kind of a sense of, there's almost like a general sense of malaise in a way that people are struggling with. And, you know, people who are also dealing with cancer is like added layer on top of that. So what we do in wellness coaching is to look at kind of the whole person, the physical side, the emotional side, all of the different components of wellness, which we're going to talk a little bit more about in detail later. So just kind of keeping in mind that the goal is that you have an overall sense of wellness. In addition, obviously that starts with physical health, but then there are layers on top of that. So moving towards wellness. So the woman on the left is having a bad day and she's feeling stressed. She's feeling maxed. She feels like she can't take one more thing, right? That's going to kind of put her over the edge. And the woman on the right could be the same woman, maybe an hour later, with a little bit of self-care, a little bit of focus, a little bit of understanding about what helps her to center inside herself, help her to find kind of what helps her to let go of what she needs to let go of and move forward. So even though these look like this woman is having a really difficult time and this woman is in like meditative bliss, they really can be the same person. But what's required of that? What's required of that is knowing yourself, knowing what you need to feel better, which looks different for absolutely everybody, and then trying to figure out how do I walk away from the picture on the left in order to feel like the picture on the right. So this is just something that I kind of changed, I edited a little bit, but you know, one of the things when Dr. Lewin was talking, and there were a lot of different things that you can do to make yourself feel well. And whether it's exercise or it's nutrition or it's, you know, meditation or it's any, or it's finding support or it's therapy, there are so many ways that we can take steps to feel better. And for a lot of us, the people around us all seem to kind of have an idea maybe of what's best for us, right? So our doctors know what's good for us on a treatment level. Our friends, our well-intended friends might think they know what's good for us. Our family might think they know what's good for us. But really, in order to make wellness changes, you have to be really in touch with what it is that you find important and what you feel well. So I just found this quote that said, I know I need to take better care of myself, but I wasn't sure what that looks like. When I asked what I should do to feel better, I got different answers. I asked a cardio instructor, I was told to do more cardio. I asked a strength coach, I was told to get into the gym or our home gyms now and lift more. If I asked a dietitian, I was told to do a cleanse. And when I asked my grandma, who smokes 2 packs of cigarettes a day, I was told not to worry about it. You look good. Who cares? Right? So what's the bottom line? The bottom line is there's a process to go through of looking inside to see what you need to feel better. And the first step to that is to ask yourself, is to even know what questions to ask yourself in order to get your wellness plan aligned with whatever your personal goals are and your physical condition. So this is just kind of repeating what I was saying, that others don't know what's best for us and we don't know what's best for other people. And in the cancer journey or in dealing with COVID, you know, there's a lot of tension around like, oh, you know, who's wearing masks, who's not wearing masks. And people are getting into this place where they kind of feel like they're in the right wherever they're coming from, so to speak. So it's a little bit like looking, you know, just kind of determining for yourself what you need to do. Right? So I know what you need. I know what you should do is to stop and say, okay, wait a second. How can I take back some kind of control and figure out what it is that I need to be doing to feel my best? And that answer lies within you. So I know that Courtney is a big fan of this, but I'm gonna show my wellness wheel. And really a lot of this has been touched on by the other presenters today, but these are all components of wellness. So nutrition, which includes not only what you eat, but your relationship between food and your health, right? A lot of us will turn to food for reasons other than physical hunger, whether it's for emotional reasons or for comfort or for loneliness or for avoidance of pain, right? So we do a lot of different, food has become more than just about nourishing our bodies. Physical activity has been mentioned. Dr. Lewin said 30 minutes 5 times a week. But then figuring out what type of exercise works best for you. It depends on where you are in your process in the cancer journey. It depends on what your background is in terms of exercise and physical activity, et cetera. Renewal is the idea of physical and mental rest. So that means taking breaks from exercise. It means taking breaks from whatever it is that you feel is kind of draining rather than giving you energy and giving you health. And sleep hygiene. This is a big one. I think especially during COVID, this is big because our rhythms are sort of off. It's like days kind of run together, days and nights kind of run together. And having, you know, we give, for children, we give them a bedtime routine. Right? So why do we do that? Because we're trying to tell their bodies and their minds, we're giving them a transition where they go from being awake and productive and moving and energized, and then they kind of have to transition to being sleepy as opposed to wakeful. So kind of keeping in mind that that might be something that you want to work on is to kind of have some kind of bedtime routine for yourself. Resiliency, I'm going to talk about a little bit more, but it's the ability to deal with difficult situations with the kind of the minimum amount of stress to your system. So, and then a lot of these things that are listed on here that help resiliency are things that the cancer support community offers. So deep breathing, meditation, guided imagery, a body scan, kind of taking a quick look, sitting down, getting quiet, and kind of looking inside to see, you know, kind of what you're feeling and what's going on in your body. Relationships, so in-person relationships in terms of seeing family members who don't live with us, that's been challenged by COVID quite a bit. There are people who either have everybody home all the time, which is hard, or people can't see the people that they normally spend time with, which is also challenging. So figuring out what you need in terms of relationships right now as things are starting to shift. Purpose is about your drive, your intentions, your passion, and your vision. What motivates you to get up in the morning? What helps you to get through your day? What are you excited to do? What do you wake up wishing you had more time for? And what do you want to accomplish in this world? And then beliefs. So your emotional feelings and thoughts, attitudes and behaviors, and accepting accountability, that the one thing that we have, you know, we have so little in our control, and COVID has taught us that we have, whether it's cancer or COVID, it's another area where they come together that we don't have ultimate control. We only have control over how we respond to whatever our situation is. So when you look at that wellness wheel, you say to yourself, you know, you can't attack everything at once. You can't change everything at once. What areas are you strong in right now? Maybe it's you're strong in exercise, or you're already a plant-based eater, or you have a really strong spiritual base and you're really good at taking time out to meditate and center yourself. And that's amazing. But what are some other areas where you'd like to change those habits? What are some other areas where you would like to, you know, where you feel need a little bit more nurturing? So I want to just talk for a minute about ways of improving health behaviors, because we can't tackle everything all at the same time. So the first question that you ask yourself is, what do you want the most? What are the most important things to you in your life? Is it family? Is it your career? Is it, you know, is it going through the cancer treatment process with a positive attitude as much as possible? What do you want the most? And then the next question, and this is really important to maintain your motivation, is to know your why. Why is that important to you? Why does that matter? And if you don't have that, what does that mean for your life? If you do have that, what does that mean for your life? And then to set very specific goals. You can set, you know, goals for a month. You can set goals for 3 months. But then that has to get broken down. So you can't, so let's say that your goal is that you want to improve how you eat, and you want to incorporate some of the health-based diets that we've been talking about today. So the first step is, in terms of being intentional, the first step is in setting goals. Okay, so what do I have to do? First, I'm going to make a shopping list of the plant-based foods that I like the best. Okay, that might be your goal for the first week or the first 3 days. Your next goal would be, okay, so where am I gonna shop for these things? How am I gonna shop for these things? Am I gonna have them delivered to the house? Am I gonna have a neighbor, you know, shop with me? How am I gonna make that happen? And break it down into goals. And that requires being intentional. That means that goes back to, what do I want? Why do I want it? Here are my goals. Now I need to come up with a plan that will help me move those forward. Support and accountability. The support can be a friend, it can be a family member, it could be a coach, it could be someone in the cancer support community. There are a lot of ways that you can find someone who's a real cheerleader for you, someone who's really gonna get behind you and encourage you, somebody who's positive about health change, and who can give you a little bit of accountability, someone that you can kind of check in with. And then the last one is that you have rewards that are in line with your goals. So for example, if you're working on maintaining a healthy body weight, you might not want to make your reward food. You might want to make your reward that you treat yourself to something else that you can buy, or you treat yourself to, you know, watching a movie, or you treat yourself to an extra long walk the next day, you take more time out, whatever it is that you feel like would be a good reward that helps you towards your goals, but that you would also be excited about. Okay, time. Time is, like, right now is a strange thing for a lot of people. So just wanted to talk about self-care a little bit in a time where there's not a lot of structure. So again, being intentional about time, that means looking at your schedule for the day, depending on what's, you know, kind of plugging in what you have to get done. And then really scheduling self-care time the same way that you would schedule any other appointment. So it requires being quite intentional. If you just say, I'll get to it when I get to it, it's probably not going to happen. So it means looking at your weekly schedule or looking at your daily schedule and saying, like, where am I going to plug these self-care items into? And then to utilize still hours. So for example, when my kids were very young, and still, which is a habit that lasts even now that they're older, is that I exercise very, very early in the morning. I do that because there are no doctor's appointments that happen then. I don't have any crises in the house. There's no, you know, it's before work. It's a time when I know that the house is gonna be quiet. It could be that night, later in the night, is quiet. It could be the middle of the day is a quiet time for you, or it could be your lunch break at work, or is to utilize those still hours to plug in self-care time. It takes a village. It goes back to the fact that when you're making changes in wellness, that it's really great to have that support around you, either other people who are trying to make changes or people who are supportive. And then to redefine in times of COVID, I think that the next two are really important, which is that we have to kind of redefine what productive looks like because the circumstances are so different now. So if you, you know, when family members went off to work or went off to school or went off to summer camp, we could plan our day in a certain way. And now it's a little more difficult to do that planning. So to have the same expectations that when the house is full and busy that you're gonna have, you know, and a lot of us, you know, don't have people coming to the house to help us with cleaning, or we don't have nursing care coming to the house, or we don't have whatever we had in terms of structure has kind of dissipated a little bit. So you have to kind of put the hammer away and be a little gentler with yourself during the times of COVID because everything is so different. So whatever your definition of productive was, it's worth taking a look at how you can redefine that so you still feel successful at the end of the day. You still feel productive and successful at the end of the day, but it's from kind of a different perspective. And then the last point on this is just that perfectionism and COVID-19 don't mix. It's really hard for things to kind of, because of the planning and because, you know, there are so many unknowns, it's this idea that we have to do things the way we did them before, and they have to be, that perfectionism tendency right now is just something to kind of put aside and understand that good enough is good enough. Whether that's in healthcare or self-care or home care or family care, it's really, or at work, it's really important to say that good enough right now is good enough. And just getting through each day feeling as positive and as strong and as well as you can is a tremendous goal. And even though it may seem harder to carve out self-care time now, it's even more important to carve out that time right now because the stresses and the strains are what they are. So I just want to say a little bit about resilience. I love this. This is an actual photograph. She's actually doing this. So obviously this is a woman who is both strong and flexible, but she didn't get this way. She didn't just walk up to a doorway. I feel like this is what's expected of us right now. In times of COVID, we're supposed to hang upside down from a doorway by our feet, right? That's kind of what life feels like right now. So she didn't get this way just because suddenly she walks up to the door, flipped herself upside down and had the strength and the flexibility to do this. She at some point started in child's pose or started in a very stiff downward dog or some other very tiny step. And then she worked at it and she practiced and she practiced and she practiced and she practiced and she strengthened and she stretched and she strengthened and she stretched. And that's really what resilience is. It's about strengthening yourself. And at the same time, you've got to stretch a little bit. You've got to stretch out of that comfort zone a little bit to kind of find that place where you feel like you're building both strength and flexibility. So that means working on the positive thinking skills, working on kind of seeing, you know, the forest instead of focusing on the trees. My father has a great saying, which I love. He said, "All good things must come to an end. So do all bad things." No bad thing lasts forever. If you look back in history, nothing terrible has ever continued to go on forever and ever, right? They all end. So it's knowing that we are gonna come out of this. We are. This is gonna, COVID, we're gonna come out of this period of time. And we can really make, like by taking good care of yourself, you can come out of it stronger, more resilient, both more flexible and more positive if you have those intentions and if you have that as a goal. So we're kind of working towards moving from, you know, some of us are working from working towards this from child's pose, right? So from a very basic place of resilience and overwhelm to learning how to kind of deep breath, know this is gonna pass, know we can get through this, know that you have this incredible support community that's available to you to help you at every step of the way, from the physical to the emotional to the social, right? You have this incredible resource available to you, which is huge. So increasing resilience, we wanna think about setting healthy boundaries. So a word on media, if I can step into this a little bit. It's okay to set boundaries about how much media you watch. I don't think a lot of us walk away from the news or the newspaper these days feeling like, wow, yeah, that really was uplifting. I feel great. That was awesome. Like, not a lot of us feel that right now. So setting boundaries around, you know, social media, standard media, if you feel like it drags you down, that may be a place that you wanna set up some boundaries. Also, having positive people around you, having positive connections, and limiting the amount of kind of negative energy that's coming at you. I think that having those kind of boundaries and knowing that, like, you might not be able to do as much as you've done in the past, because getting regular things done, whether it's shopping or getting to the doctor or getting to treatments, have more complexity now. So it could be that there are other things that you wanna kind of put aside for now. This next one I really like a lot, which is ask for what you need instead of focusing on what others aren't doing. So a lot of my clients are moms and they get very frustrated that their kids don't help, right? Why aren't my kids helping me? Why aren't my friends checking in with me? How come, you know, we get frustrated by what others aren't doing? And I think a more positive way is to get clear on what you need. I feel lonely right now. I feel like my friends don't check in with me enough. Maybe I can ask them if they could check in with me, you know, once a week just to see how I'm doing. That would make me feel better. Focus on what you need and then ask for that instead of focusing. Ask your kids, you know, or ask the people around you, hey, I'm having a hard time getting all this done myself. I really like it. I feel much clearer and more calm when the house is neat. Do you think you could help me with that? Do you think you can unload the dishwasher? Do you think you can, you know, do you think you can, whatever it is, fold the laundry, right? That big picture focus that we talked about in terms of the forest and trees, and that this will, you know, that there will be an endpoint to all of this. Gratitude, appreciating what you do have. We keep, like, I have a little gratitude jar where, like, at the end of the day, three things on each gets a piece of paper and you stuff it into the jar. And then when you're feeling kind of not so great, you go back in and pluck one out and you're like, oh, right, I forgot. And it can be as small as I had such an awesome cup of coffee this morning to, you know, something major, like I feel more energetic today, or I had a good doctor's appointment, or my scan was clean. Whatever it is, like, things that can be tiny and things, you know, the sun came up this morning and I got to see it. Or whatever, it can be very small, very big. And then to do things that really increase joy, whatever that looks like, the things that make you happy, the things that make you feel more present, the things that help you feel relaxed and joyful in the world. And then I just want to share with you, for those of you who are more tech savvy, I just wanted to share some resources with you. First of all, my email. I am happy to be here as another resource for anybody who has questions about making health and wellness changes and making them last. You're welcome to reach out to me. MyFitnessPal is a great way to track what you're eating if you're looking to make health changes and increasing awareness. Headspace is a meditation app, which is neat. A lot of good things on there. FitPlan is also a way to track your fitness and to give you ideas in terms of fitness. Sleep Cycle is about that sleep hygiene and helping get you into a good sleep routine and checking your sleep quality. Aptiv is an app where you can find, I think, probably 10,000 different workouts that you can do at home. Really, really easy. And 8Fit is very similar. It's also an exercise app, but it's focused on HIIT training, which is high intensity interval training. Aptiv has much more of a variety, whereas 8Fit is kind of a little more high intensity, but it all can be done from any smartphone, tablet, computer. This is actually a typo. It's Happify, not happily. Sorry about that. Happify is a positive thinking app, which is nice if you're trying to work on reducing negative thoughts and increasing positive thoughts. And HealthTap is an app where you can actually speak directly to a physician through this app if you have questions. And so I just wanted to give a list of resources kind of to help you, you know, move towards that next step. So again, I want to thank you all for coming, and let me see if I can get out of this screen share. There we go. So I just want to thank everybody so much, and here if you have any questions.
Hi. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Atara, for all of your information. And we just want to introduce our next speaker, who is Charlotte Stone. She is the owner and founder of Stone Yoga in Teaneck. And she's going to be sharing with us some meditation tips and from some mindful breathing techniques.
Hi, I'm Charlotte. Thank you very much for inviting me, Courtney. I'm so grateful for the program that you have, and so delighted to be here with all these wonderful speakers. And I'm grateful for the students who come, because without them, what would we all do? Ready to play with. So you tasked me with the idea of offering some ideas about meditation. So in 15 minutes, we're all going to become meditation masters. And here's how we're going to do that. Most people, when you talk about meditation, they immediately think, well, I can't do that. I can't get my mind to be quiet. I can't focus. I can't, you know, I think meditation is all about being perfect or quieting the mind. That is not true. So I want to take that burden right off you. Here's more like what meditation is really about. If you think back to, I want to tell you a story really. When you think back millions of years, this is probably where meditation began. The cavemen would go out in the morning after a hearty breakfast, and they would go and find a saber-toothed tiger, maybe it found them, and they would run after it, and you know that took a while, and then all together they would slaughter this animal. Then they had to drag it home, so a bunch of guys got together and carried this thing home, and with great triumph they presented it in their village, and you know they brought it to the women, who then have to work hard to skin the hide and turn that into tents or clothing or whatever it is that they made. If they were in a cave, maybe they had to make blankets and things to not be cold. So they were all very busy, and then they all made dinner and used some of the meat from other animals they had caught. And so they were tired at the end of the day, and the men gathered in the cave or around a campfire, and they told stories. You know, the saber-toothed tiger was this big, and then somebody, well, no, I killed it actually, and it was this big. And you know, the stories would grow, and they would pass around a little pipe and smoke a little something, and you know, that was legal in those days. And so they would relax, and they would finally be done with their singing and their gratitude to their gods. And after they ate and they were satisfied, they would sit and look at the fire flickering. They would listen to the pops and crackles, and they would settle into a quieter state. I'm convinced that that was the first type of meditation that people had, that they would sit and simply let the mind quiet a little bit on a certain object of their attention. And in that case, it was the fire. And then they would go home and, you know, be with their families and go to sleep. And the next day they'd wake up and do it all over again. So really what they had is meditation as a form to relax, as a form to quiet the mind a little bit, and as a way to help themselves to reduce stress, to be what you mentioned before, to be more resilient. And so maybe that was the first approach to meditation. Of course, by now we know there are many different ways to meditate. There's affirmation, and there's prayer, and there's mantra, and there's transcendental meditation, and there's moving meditations like gentle yoga, qigong, and tai chi, and there's walking meditation. You could even argue that even knitting or painting or singing or playing an instrument, if it takes all of your awareness, then it qualifies as meditation. It's not like if you're doing something and watching TV, then you're not meditating. But if you're doing some sculpting and that's taking up all of your awareness, that is a meditative activity. There's mindfulness meditation. There's transcendental meditation. So many forms of meditation. We don't really have to worry about all of those because what happens is you'll encounter something that you'll like. You'll find a meditation form that kind of speaks to you. So whether it's mindfulness meditation, more along the lines of the MBSR, the mindfulness-based stress reduction work that they do at UMass, or it's more of a guided imagery type of thing, you'll very quickly know this appeals to me, that doesn't. And to tell you the truth, I was introduced to mindfulness meditation years ago in 1973, and I thought that was the bee's knees. And then I learned from really the cancer survivors that I got to work with at Gilda's Club that they didn't like that meditation very much. At some point, someone said to me, you know, this being present to what isn't all it's cracked up to be? Can't you sort of take us away? And I thought, well, what's that? And I found all about, there's something called guided imagery, visualization. And I started to study that and found that that was a wonderful approach for, especially for cancer survivors or anyone going through crisis. Sometimes focusing on the present moment is not what you want. Sometimes what you really want is to be anywhere but in the present moment. And so we're going to look today at a few different types of meditation. So let's practice one. I think that's the most fun thing to do. If you think about meditation, I like Joan Borisenko's definition. She says, meditation is settling the mind pleasantly and lightly on your chosen object of attention. So it's light, it's gentle. It's not, you know, you have to ace the course. It's not like that. It's just, let's choose something we can be aware of for a little while. This, what we're going to do now is called breathing awareness. So just like you might do a body scan, or you might notice sounds or your thoughts and just sit with them, the breath is always available. We don't need any tools. And the truth is, you don't even need a guide. You don't need a teacher. You can do this at a doctor's office, especially if you're sitting there and you're nervous and you're waiting, or if you're commuting to work or something. Breath awareness is a really nice way to keep the mind pleasantly occupied. So we're all sitting at home in the safety of our homes. So why don't we try this? You might want to close your eyes or have your eyes look down so that your gaze is soft. So you might have your eyes open, that's fine, but you're not looking at anything in particular. So take a few moments to get yourself seated comfortably. You can even lie down, but if you fall asleep, that's on you. That's, you know, that's fine, and nobody's checking and nobody can see you, so that's good too. So allow your eyes to gently close. And take a moment to organize things so that you're comfortable. Maybe you're sitting in a posture of comfort and dignity. This may be the first time today that you're actually focusing on your breathing in a way that is conscious, that you're choosing to do. Maybe choosing to notice the breath right at the tip of your nose, right at the nostrils. You may notice the gentle flare of the nostrils, that sensation. Or you might notice the temperature of the breath as you breathe in. The breath is somewhat cool. As you breathe out, the breath is a little more warm and spent. The body has used it and it's leaving. So we'll keep the attention right there at the tip of the nose. If you prefer, you can also notice the movement of the breath in the throat, or the way that it moves your chest or your abdomen. So choose one point. This is called one-pointed awareness. I'm going to go with the breath right at the nostrils, noticing the breath as it moves in and how it changes and becomes an exhalation and moves out. If it's difficult, you might even label what you're doing, breathing in, breathing out. There's no need to change the rhythm. Just do your natural breath pace. Staying with the breath. Breathing in. Breathing out as you label what you're doing to keep your mind present. And of course, the mind will wander. It'll wander 1,000 times. And every time you notice that, don't beat yourself up about it. It's light, remember? It's gentle. So gently guide your attention back to what you're doing. This breath now. This one moment as the breath comes in and then leaves. I'll be quiet for just a moment so that we can practice this. And slowly let that go, letting your attention now expand a bit. Notice the difference between that one-pointed awareness and returning to the busy world where we live most of the time. just noticing how you feel now that you've spent a few minutes doing breath awareness exercise. So that's one form of meditation that is right there, always available, and you can expand that to pay attention to thoughts, to sounds, but that's a beginning. This first foray into just this raw and simple awareness of the breath. So I was teaching things like that for quite a while at Gilda's until someone taught me that maybe we should be doing something else. And so this idea of guided imagery, of visualization, things that are taught by people like Carolyn Mace or Shakti Gawain and many, many others, I fell in love with this. Because sometimes when you're really stressed, when you're having a very hard time and you sort of can't get yourself together, you may not find that you can do the breath awareness. Maybe you can't focus on the mindful moment. What's so great about the mindful moment, my students told me. And I had a hard time answering because someone going through this cancer experience, this cancer survivorship, is expending a lot of energy and having to fight and having to really pull it together often. And so maybe mindfulness was not what they needed. I found that two types of guided imagery were helpful. And really, I learned this from my students. One was to have guided imagery, a story that could take the stress away, it could take the cancer away, at least for a little while. And so I came up with imageries like scrubbing bubbles, you know, the Dow Chemical ones, like you pour them into the bathtub and they scrub away all the dirt. Well, here we could have scrubbing bubbles that we could imagine, for example, people who felt that the chemo was a noxious poison. This is not exactly a healing image. What if instead we could imagine the chemo as a healing, a scrubbing bubbles type of a thing that would remove the cancers, but leave the rest of us healthy and shiny and clean and beautiful and grateful for this body, as opposed to feeling the body as an enemy. So we worked a little bit with scrubbing bubbles, and I worked with Pac-Man and lots of images like that, and people like that. So that was take the cancer away, take the problem away. I also found that people really related to the idea of, well, maybe I don't really even believe in the take the cancer away or take the problem away. How about you take me away? Can we go on a journey? Can you take me to somewhere else? Because I'm really tired of being here. And so that's what I'd like to share with you next, this idea of going on a little mental vacation for a little bit. So why don't we try that next? So again, if you feel like it, find yourself settled in your chair, get really comfortable, and take a nice full breath. And as you exhale, really settle in. Again, you might have a posture of comfort and dignity, finding just the right balance between, I'm so comfortable here, sitting here or lying down, but I'm not going to fall asleep. I'm just aware. I can follow this voice that's going to tell me a story and take me on a flight of imagination. So allowing the eyes to be soft, or maybe allowing your eyes to close. A moment to feel where you are and to feel safe now as you imagine yourself not in this chair and not even in this room, but maybe you've taken a little drive into the country. You're out on the countryside and you've traveled along a highway to get there, and then you pull off to a smaller country road. And then you pull down along a little dirt road alongside the highway and a little bit off the country road. And it takes you to a parking space right near the woods. And you know that you're meant to park there, so you leave your car. And you have comfortable shoes on, and so you begin to take this pleasant walk. It's a nice day. It's sunny, but not too hot. You walk through the woods. It's beautiful. The sun glinting through the branches of the trees, and trees give you some shade. And you find that the walk is easy. And you walk along this path and you come to a clearing. And oddly, there's a magic carpet there. Well, that's weird. But one corner beckons to you, and you realize, I think it wants me to ride the magic carpet. And even though you may feel just a little silly, you decide I'm going to do it. You say to them, I don't like heights. And it's kind of lets you know you're going to be safe. You're fine. You're always safe on this journey. And so you clamber up onto this magic carpet. And it slowly lifts up just a little bit. Seems to check on you. Are you okay? And the answer is yes. And so it lifts a little higher. And it begins to hover above the ground. It takes you a little higher over the treetops. You see now where you took your little walk through the trees. It lifts you just a little higher over toward the hills. And you rise up even higher than that over the green rolling hills and all the way up over the snow-capped mountains, far away from the busy city. And it sets you down in a beautiful, beautiful mountain meadow filled with flowers, just gorgeous. That's where it sets you down, on this soft bed of flowers. You're supposed to get off of the ride here. That becomes clear. And as you step off the magic carpet, you see that there's a little meandering path moving along, and it heads toward what you hear. Oh, there's a little creek, a little stream, and you can hear the gurgling. And so you follow the sound toward this beautiful area where all of a sudden you see the creek. It's cascading down up above. There's a mountain that you can see from the higher mountain. There's a beautiful waterfall. You hear it splashing. It splashes down into a pond. And then it runs down this beautiful creek, this little stream that you found. It's soothing. You love the sound of the water. Maybe you even sit down on a boulder, or maybe there's a bench there that seems to be waiting for you. So you have a seat. Or maybe you'd prefer to walk right to the water's edge. Maybe that's what you do. Maybe you even scoop your hand in and take a little sip of water right from your hand. It's so crystal clear, cool, and refreshing. And you sit down on the bench, and you hear the beautiful breeze, a little breeze brushing through the leaves of the trees behind you. It's so relaxing there. You feel the cool water that you drank, soothing and calming. The sound of this stream just so relaxing now. And oddly, right next to you on the bench, there seems to be there's a notepad. That's strange. So there's a pen there. You pick up the notepad. It's beautiful, it's ornate, and the pen is so delicate and beautiful. And you open up the notepad. There's nothing but blank pages. And it seems that you're meant to write something on a page in the notepad. What are you going to write? You don't know if you have all day. So you realize you've arrived here with some worries, some concerns. Maybe life isn't just all perfect right now. And so you recognize that you could unburden yourself a little bit. You could write down maybe the top three or the top five, or okay, maybe the top 10 things that are on your mind right now. What is weighing on your shoulders? You think about that a little bit. And you choose a few of these ideas to write down. You write down one, and then another comes to mind, and another, and suddenly what seemed like, oh my gosh, how would I choose? So many come to mind. Or maybe there's just one or two ideas that have truly been weighing you down. And so you write these ideas down on that page in this notepad. You click the pen and set it aside, and you already feel a little lighter. But now what to do? But do you leave it there? That's strange too. Oh, you decide I'm going to rip off this one piece of paper on which you've written all of these different worries and burdens. You set the rest of the notebook aside, maybe for another visitor to use. What to do with this one piece of paper? And kind of playfully, you turn it into a little paper sailboat. Oh, okay. Oh, that's nice. What to do with the sailboat? Oh, there's that little stream, that creek running downstream. And so you get up from your bench and you take your little paper sailboat and you walk right up to the water's edge, maybe over some smooth river pebbles, some river stones. And you lean forward a little bit and you set your little sailboat down right into the water. And then you stand up and you wonder, what's going to happen next? Well, here's what happens. First, nothing. You're a little disappointed. But after just a little while, a little current of water starts to catch the sailboat and it pulls it a little farther away from the shore, more out into the center of the stream. Along the way, it seems to catch on a branch, and yet the water, with its persistent nature, keeps tugging at it and tugging at it, and you watch and marvel as the water pulls this one piece of paper, your little sailboat, farther and farther out. There are more twigs and branches sticking out into the stream, but this beautiful little sailboat rides this current and it slips around those branches. And you watch it and you start to squint because it's moving farther and farther away. And then you watch until it's just a tiny little white dot on the horizon. And then it rounds the bend and it's gone. And you notice that you're standing taller, that your breath is more free and easy. Your body feels more comfortable, more light, more fluid, more at ease inside your own skin. Smiling, you gaze out over the stream and you feel gratitude. You gaze up at the sun, the gentle sun, and you smile. And standing tall, feeling so comfortable now, you take the walk back, you find the magic carpet, and you sit on it once again. And gently it lifts off and carries you way up high, leaving this magical place. You can still see that stream if you look over the edge of your carpet. It's a beautiful memory. And it carries you over the snow-capped mountains and over the rolling green hills and all the way back to this little woods that you walk through. And it sets you down ever so gently. And you walk back through the trees, cool and comfortable and relaxed and much more at ease with yourself. And you get all the way back to your car. And slowly you get in, you drive back, all the way back to the busy city where you began this journey. And you arrive back right here and now into this room where we started, feeling the better for the journey that you've taken. Arriving home again, safe and sound, feeling good. And noticing how you feel right now, maybe something's shifted. Something inside has changed. Maybe you really wanted to stay at the river. But remember, this is just one breath away. It's available with just in the blink of an eye. You can use your imagination and return there. So that's just one of many, many guided imagery journeys that we can take. There are so many. For now, I'd actually like to end with just something that is called the metta meditation. Metta is a word in Pali, comes from Tibet. Metta means loving kindness or loving friendship. So if you'd like, settle in for one more very short meditation, the loving kindness meditation. Again, sitting with a posture of comfort and dignity, the eyes closed or gently open but soft. See yourself now sitting at the center of a circle. And maybe today is the day that you need to hear these four blessings, these four wishes, really. May I be safe, you say to yourself. May I be happy. May I be healthy, and may I be at ease. And it feels nice to send out those wishes or affirmations. But since you're sitting in a circle, maybe you could also extend these wishes to someone else. Maybe you're a support person for someone that is very dear to you. And so maybe you could extend this wish to them too. See their face clearly in your mind's eye, and we can wish this to them. May you be safe. May you be happy. May you be healthy. May you be at ease. And there may even be people that you don't know, that you don't know well anyway. It could be maybe the person who delivers your mail, or the person who manages the parking lot at Holy Name. You don't know them well, but they're there. And they too could use these blessings. May they be safe. May they be happy. May they be healthy. And may they be at ease. And now imagining a world where there are so many who are having a hard time, who are suffering. Maybe we can wish this to all of them. May all beings be safe. May all beings be happy. May all beings be healthy. And may all beings be at ease. And imagine them receiving this, a heart blessing from you to them. You may never know them or meet them. Doesn't matter. And as the circle widens, you've reached all the way out to people who may be thousands of miles away. And here's the beauty of this. Around the world, there are millions of people doing this meditation. I'd like you to imagine them way out there in the farthest reaches of these circles. They're there, and the person they're wishing these wishes to is you. So sit in the center of your circle now and hear and feel these blessings as all of these hundreds of thousands and millions of people wish this to you. May you be safe. May you be happy. May you be healthy. And may you be at ease. Take it into your heart and into your spirit and let it lift you up. So I'd like to end there. Thank you again for giving me the opportunity to offer a few different types of meditation. And thank you to Holy Name and to Dr. Lewin and to Courtney Lozano and everyone involved here, and to the beautiful students who help us to be our best and give us the opportunity to serve. Namaste, everybody.
Thank you so much, Charlotte. That was wonderful. Thank you, thank you. I think we're all feeling super relaxed. And between Atara and Charlotte, we've gotten a lot of information, and we're looking forward to our next speaker, who will be Pegeen Cushing. She's actually from the Feel More Like You program that I talked about earlier today. And she is a beauty consultant that will be helping us learn more about the health and beauty tips that can be offered through that program. So Pegeen, welcome.
Good morning, everyone. Courtney, thank you for having me. I'm just getting my screen set up here. I'd like to thank Courtney, first of all, for including me. In today's presentation. So my name is Pegeen Cushing, and I am here on behalf of Walgreens as a beauty area expert to inform you on a unique service that we offer that helps you feel and look more like yourself during and after cancer treatment. So when you go through cancer treatment, most people expect to get nauseous, fatigued, and maybe lose their hair. But there are many other side effects, both on the inside and outside, that may take you by surprise. And side effects like changes to the skin, the nails, loss of hair, eyebrows, right? And that can impact your sense of self even more. So, please excuse. When you have the support and guidance to address both the internal and the outside external changes that are making you feel like a stranger, it can really give you a physical and mental boost, and it can help you define how you're going to face the treatments instead of it letting define you, right? So, people in cancer treatment and beyond need a convenient and expert service that boosts the self-image and confidence by addressing a full range of side effects from the skin and hair changes to the occasional nausea and fatigue. So that's where our Feel More Like You service comes into play. And before 2018, there really wasn't a retail setting around that offered this service. So we understood that there was a need for a place for people to go where they could get help with feeling and looking more like themselves. So with our long history of being a trusted pharmacy and beauty retailer, we were confident that we had the experience and resources to fill this need. But to make sure that we got it right, we would talk to many people along the way to hear firsthand what they were experiencing and what they wanted from a pharmacy and beauty retailer that would service and address their needs. So with that said, that's where our partnership came in, and we partnered with the cancer support community and another organization like Look Good, Feel Better to develop a training that we can put in place to train our beauty consultants and our pharmacists to provide that right support and guidance for our customers. So based on all our planning and collaboration with the cancer support community and the Look Good, Feel Better teams, we're taking a specialty approach with our trained pharmacists and beauty consultants leading the way to support people experiencing with both the internal and visible side effects. Please note that the service is free. We want to provide you that support, and no appointment is needed. So now I'm going to talk to you about the beauty services. We have specially trained beauty consultants that basically provide individualized makeup tips and tricks and guidance on products that they can help you with, like hair loss, dry hair, dry skin, skin discoloration, sun protection, changes to the nails and cuticles. We also have trained our pharmacists, and they can provide tips over the counter on products to help you relieve symptoms that include occasional nausea, vomiting, skin rash, increased fatigue, mouth sores. But in today's world, you may not be comfortable coming into the store and working with our beauty consultants and our pharmacists side by side. So this is now where we offer our website. And this is a great tool designed specifically to provide you with that side effect help. So you can really, you can go on our website and experiencing the Walgreens.com Feel More Like You page, and you can choose which side effect you want help with. We also offer tips and tools on our website. You can find step-by-step videos featuring Walgreens Beauty Consultant that demonstrate these tips virtually. And they're based on hair, skin, nail discomforts, really, really cool videos that can help you along the way. Also, one thing I'm very passionate about here is the Feel More Like You podcast that we have through our website, again, walgreens.com/feelmorelikeyou. Really great episodes where you can hear from beauty experts, medical and pharmacy experts, as well as women who share their personal stories. And these are the available episodes right now. So you have your intro, talking about how beauty is much more than makeup, hair loss, so how-tos. How to maintain and take care of wigs, clippers, cold caps, emotional wellness, from cope to hope, mouth and taste changes, sore subject, and breast changes, surgeries, implants, tattoos. And for that, you can visit Walgreens.com podcast. And all of this information is available through our website. So whether you're looking at coming into store and visiting one of our specialty trained beauty consultants or pharmacists, or you're visiting the website, we're here and we now have 12,000 trained pharmacists and 3,000 trained beauty consultants that can help you specifically with your needs. So to find the nearest participating location, visit walgreens.com, Feel More Like You. And we have a store locator, really easy to use. You can just type in your zip code where you can access the closest, the nearest, participating location. So thank you very much for having me today. And I'm excited to share more information with you in the future, partnering with Courtney at the Cancer Support Community. Hopefully we can get on their calendar to offer maybe some live virtual trainings on specific areas of the face and skincare. Basically answer any more questions you have if you have specific concerns around your beauty personal care needs. Thank you.
I would really love to thank all of the panelists. This was really phenomenal. I have to say, this is the first time in a long time that I have actually sat back, relaxed, listened, and really taken notes on the things that I need to change in my own life. So I really want to thank you all so much. This is such important information for our cancer survivors and really everyone in general. There were a few questions that came through in the chat box, so I would love to address those. First of all, there was really a wonderful compliment. I hope you could all see it, that just said, thank you so much for such a great event. So happy this was put together. Look forward to this event every year. And again, it really gave this person time to think about herself as I did as well too. There were a couple of questions that came through for Debbie. Maybe Debbie or Courtney, you could address if the recipes will be available. As well as the recording from today or the cooking recording. Will those things be available for participants or maybe people that couldn't participate?
Yes, we're actually going to be sending out like a thank you email to everyone when this is all finished up, and we will include the email which with Debbie's recipes included. So you'll definitely get that.
Super. There was a question, a couple of questions for Debbie. She's always so popular at these events because nutrition is so important. Debbie, could you comment on how much oatmeal you used in the pancakes? Maybe it will actually say that once the recipe is emailed to everyone. And while you're also there, Debbie, if you can still hear me too, there were a couple of questions about sugar intake and cancer. So if you could, you know, not only comment about the oatmeal that you used in your recipe, but also about sugar and how it pertains to cancer prevention and wellness, that would be great.
Yes, of course. Hello, and it was a great event. Thank you, Courtney, for putting all this together. Thank you, other participants. So the oatmeal question, you will see it on the recipe. I believe it was 1.5 cups. And like I said in the video, I usually don't buy oat flour because it's so easy to make your own just using regular oats and blending them. Regarding the sugar question, yes, everyone really should be decreasing their simple sugars. Simple sugars like regular sugar, brown sugar, which some people think is a little healthier and really isn't. Even, you know, honey is okay, just, you know, in moderation, but any simple sugar like that. The goal is to keep your insulin levels at bay, which is a environment for cancer to grow. A lot of insulin, I can get into that. I can get into that if we have time, but I don't think we do. And I think that was the only question, Dr. Lewin. Or?
That was the main question. That was the main question. A lot of compliments are actually coming through in the chat box. So thank you all for your comments. Please do if you, oh, someone said it was so nice to see all of our unmasked faces. Yes, I know when you come to the office, we're all masked now and you can't see us completely. One more question, maybe someone on the panel could address, you know, how you recommend exercising in the heat and the humidity, because we all have mentioned the importance of physical activity. What are your strategies? Maybe a couple of you could address that, given the humidity and heat, how do we really encourage people to still exercise outside and stay healthy? Atara, do you want to take that one? That's a great question.
Sure. So I think I saw in the chat that someone specifically asked about walking, and then I'll address it in general. But in terms of outdoors, is that, you know, the highest humidity, the coolest temperature time is obviously very early in the morning. The flip side of that is the highest humidity is also early in the morning. So it really depends on when you feel, you know, that is to get out before the sun comes up. It doesn't have to, like, it's light out, but before the sun is really on the area that you're walking, or to do it in the evening if there's a safe place for you to walk, if you have a walking partner, if there's somebody, you know, walking is so fantastic because it's such a great way to stay healthy. And at the same time, it's so accessible. You need a pair of shoes and you need somewhere safe to walk. And that's really it. So that's wonderful. There are a couple of online walking programs, believe it or not. So one of them is called Walk at Home by Leslie Sansone. Her last name is spelled S-A-N-S-O-N-E. There's also something called Get Healthy and then the letter U and TV, which is also another online program. And then there's something called the 10,000 Indoor Step Challenge by Joanna Soh, S-O-H. So if you're more inclined, if the weather's really terrible and it's just like there isn't a time when you can do it outside, so then you can, you know, check out some of those online resources. You can always text them to Courtney also if she wants to send that out with the recipes, if that would be helpful. But your best bets really are, you know, early in the morning. You're gonna kind of trade temperature for humidity a little bit, but it's really whichever works best for you. So that's what I would say about that.
Perfect. There's so much data all the time now about how important walking is. So some people think they need to do very strenuous exercise, but you don't necessarily have to. There was a question about strength training. Is there a need to still walk? Strength training is excellent. If you have the ability to do that, that's great. I think there's a lot of benefits for walking as well too. So if you're able to do, gardening is considered exercising. I think we have time just one for one more question. This is a question for Debbie about intermittent fasting. This always tends to come up in a lot of our webinars. So Debbie, could you give us your thoughts about intermittent fasting, what exactly that is, and how that pertains to health and wellness?
Yes, I do like intermittent fasting. There's a few different ways to do it. The one that I choose because of the ease of it and because of the studies behind it is the one where you're eating within 8 hours during the day. So your breakfast, lunch, and dinner is all within 8 hours. You can pick your own 8 hours, 10 to 6, 12 to 7, depending on your lifestyle. And studies have shown that this improves your your metabolism, your digestion. It improves glucose and lipid levels as well.
A lot of compliments again coming through the chat box. Thank you so much. Before I say my concluding remarks, I just want to see if Jean or Courtney want to say anything.
I would just thank you all for participating. Thank the panelists. Thank you, Courtney. And thank you to all the participants. This has been really wonderful for me to hear as well and for me to think about how to conduct my life. So I appreciate being here with you guys today. And it is nice to see faces close, close but far away. Thanks, Sharon.
Thank you. Courtney.
Yeah, I just wanted to say everyone did such a great job. I think we learned a lot. Different things we can implement in our own lives. And it was fabulous. Thank you all for being here. We have such a powerhouse of women here today. So thank you all for being here.
It's so true. Such a powerhouse of women. I absolutely love to see that. You know, there were a few other questions that came through for Debbie that we don't necessarily have time for, but I'll ask Courtney to send out the phone number if you want to make an individual consultation appointment with Debbie and her team. She can talk to you a lot about individual nutrition planning and things of that sort. So Courtney, if you would go ahead and send that out with the email, that would be great. But I just want to thank Courtney so much for putting this together. What a fantastic job. I mean, she has been such a pleasure to work with in the cancer support community for all the wonderful things she's done for our patients. Please thank you, panelists, for all your time and your dedication to our patients, not only today, but in the courses that you run for them throughout the year. This was really, really phenomenal. And so thank you, team. I have to say what a special place Holy Name is. I think you've all felt it once you've walked through the doors here or called. You know, I practiced in the city for quite some time, and the care that we take for our patients, especially our cancer patients, is, you know, unparalleled anywhere else. So it's really proud to be a part of this team, and just thank you all. Everyone, please stay safe, and thank you for joining us today.